So if you have two tones, one at 40 hertz and one at 400 hertz, and I say they're the same magnitude, so we measure exactly the same decibel level or pressure level in pascals, is one of these going to be louder to an observer? Well, this is exactly what we talked about, the A weighting curve, right? One of those is going to be more perceivable to a human being than another, and that's going to be 400 hertz, because if we look at the A weighting curve down at 40 hertz, the A weighting curve is saying you need to attenuate that level by 35 dB. It's 35 dB lower in amplitude to a human being than, say, 400 hertz. Okay, so even though they're the same sound pressure level, 400 hertz is going to appear to be louder to a human being. That's what A weighting did for us. Very simple curve to this A-weighting shape, and so it doesn't have all of the nuances of that map of the United States that we looked at earlier. That's what these guys are for, and these are called the equal loudness contours or curves. And what these guys do for us is exactly the same thing A-weighting was trying to do, but it's just a much more sophisticated system. Okay, so we see sort of that southern coastline of the United States, see the Texas region here, we see the California region, we even see the Florida represented a little bit here as well, okay? And so what these equal loudness contours are doing for us is they're saying, let's say I've got a tone at 100 hertz and it's 50 decibels, so you got sound pressure level over here on the left, frequency along the x-axis, and I've got a 100 hertz tone at 50 decibels. And what these equal loudness curves are saying is that I move that frequency down, but I keep it on this blue line. I move it down to 30 hertz. Now it's nearly 80 dB, but it's all touching this same blue line. That tells me that a human being is going to say those two tones at different frequencies are going to be equally loud. Okay, they're both touching this line, and I've highlighted it here in magenta. This line in magenta is the definition of a new unit we're going to use called sone. Okay, so one sone is this line with all of its frequency dependency built right in. As long as you're touching this line, you get the same loudness value, and we'll say that's the loudness of one sone.
Okay. Any tone that hits that line is called one sone and sounds equally loud.
That's right. Yep.
I was going to say that must be why they call it the equal loudness curves. It's making sense to me.
That's right. So before, if you remember earlier in a conversation, just knowing that a noise is 50 dB or a certain level isn't enough information. We had to say it's 50 dB at X hertz, right? Because 50 dB at 20 hertz is way different loudness than 50 dB at 200 hertz. With the sone, we don't have to worry about that. One sone is one sone. I don't have to give you any more information, okay? Now, if I was going to say, let's make it even more convenient. Remember, we had this weird 6 dB thing with the doubling of sound pressure. Remember that aspect of decibels, Pete?
Yeah.
If you were to...
That was very weird.
In a perfect world, what would be twice as loud as one sone?
Twice as loud? Two sones.
Yeah, and that's exactly what it is.
The world's perfect.
The world of sones and loudness is perfect. Two sones is exactly twice as loud as one sone. If we double that again, they will see that four sones is twice as loud as two sones. Okay? So we perfectly linearize the perception of loudness with this unit, sones. It works in the opposite direction, and you say half as loud as one sone is half a sone, and then a quarter sone, and so on down to the threshold of hearing. Okay? So the sone unit bakes in the frequency dependency of our hearing shown by the map of the United States, and it perfectly linearizes our perception. So if I say something's 80 sones and something's 40 sones, that second sound is half as loud as the first one, okay? And it's very, very convenient. No longer have to worry about this 6 dB thing, 10 dB being roughly the perceived twice as loud thing. We didn't talk about that in explicit detail, but to a microphone, 6 dB is an actual doubling. To a human being, you don't get a perceived doubling until about 10 dB.
Wow, that just makes it even more confusing.
Yeah, so it's way, way, very complicated. Sones takes care of everything. in terms of perceived loudness, and that's why it's used in sound quality for actual human perceived loudness. Pete's going to do a demonstration of the Sohn and how we can use it in SimCenter Test Lab to help us figure out the loudness of our object.
I have two sounds here, Scott, and one is labeled brand A. You see it's 95.76 dB. Brand B, it's 95.35 dB. Is that a big difference in dB-wise, Scott?
No, not at all.
That's like hardly a difference, right? So these two sounds, brand A and brand B, and they are vacuum cleaners, this is going to be exciting, are nearly identical. So I'll play them for you, but tell me if you can hear a difference between them. There's A. And there is B. I'll play them for you again. So, A. What did you think, Scott?
Well, they definitely sound different, but I would say A sounds louder to me as well.
Yeah, a bit louder, different. A little yep. more shrill or something.
Yep.
So you thought A was a bit louder than B, and they definitely sounded different. From a dB point of view, we hardly saw any difference at all. So we need to calculate this thing called Sohns, and see if we can see a difference using Sohns rather than dB. So I'll right-click here, Options, because it's pretty easy here in SimCenter Test Lab. And I can pick ISO Loudness 532B. That's the latest standard for Sohns. Hit Apply here. And A is 83 Sohns. B is 63 Sohns. So it's about a quarter as loud. Whereas dB was hardly showing a difference before, there's a big difference here with Sohns. Would you agree, Scott, that Sohns is tracking better with your impressions of the sound?
Yes, much better in Sohns. That's kind of how I perceived it.
Sweet. We can go a little bit further here. If you look at B versus A, anything stand out to you?
Yeah, A seems to have some peaks, some kind of tones in there.
Yeah, A has some peaks. And we can actually grab a filter here. As I'm playing the sound, I can move this filter around and I can take out and modify the sound in real time. So I can actually make it pretty narrow, line up on that peak, and turn this filter on and off. Did you hear a difference there as I turned the filter on and off?
Absolutely. Big difference.
So there's 85 Sohns without the filter. If I applied the filter, I'm taking out about 10 Sohns of sound. So this is kind of useful, being able to do a filter and having the metric. I can see like, oh, okay, I'm going to improve the sound quite a bit, like 10 Sohns worth if I take that tone out. There's some other tones here too. There's one up here, right? And if I was to take this one on and off, does that make much of a difference zone-wise?
Not a big difference.
Not a big difference. Let's take a listen to that one. Turn it on. Could you hear a difference there?
No.
No, not really. So this is kind of useful too. When we see different tones in the sound, Sohns can tell us which one of those tones we really need to go after to improve or change the loudness. You know, we don't want to spend a lot of time going after this frequency when this one is actually the big hitter, right? So hopefully that kind of illustrates how you can use Sohns to identify sound. And in fact, if you combine this with something like the sound camera, it's pretty powerful because you can then locate where this sound is coming from, right, versus this one, and figure out how to reduce the sound.
So just to summarize, this unit of Sohns perfectly linearizes our perceived loudness, so it's much more convenient than decibels for amplitude or loudness as perceived by a human being. And it's nice that it's nice and linear for us.